Before Jan and Susan joined the group, I was sort of a subordinate member. I was just a paid singer at that stage. Very badly paid as well, come to think of it. We were such an arty band. When the original four-guy thing got together, two of the guys were out of a theatre group. One of the guys was at film school making his own films. It was as important to us that we'd heard Clockwork Orange as it was that we'd heard David Bowie. We loved all branches of weird cinema and things. We were told videos were the thing we had to do too that afternoon, and we did Circus of Death and Empire State Human, that were the sort of most saleable tracks off our odd first album. So I just remember standing at the top of a stack of speakers and singing like I was in Iron Maiden or something, which I think was my idea, and quite a nice shot with a cat. I like cats. And now I'm 14 stories high. And we were desperate to have something different. We'd been absolutely thrilled by David Bowie and Roxy Music and Mark Bolan. You know, when Sweet went on TV, we went, wow, just because we'd never seen it before. And if you've got something that you've never seen before, it's giving kids something that their parents didn't have. And that's what kids need when they're adolescent. They need their own thing. It's actually good if their parents don't like it. We'd been this group that everyone was talking about. Big news, David Bowie came to see us and all that sort of stuff. Then we signed to a major, and people forget now that indie fans don't like you when you sign to a major. And it looked like it was all over. They're sort of going to let us have a little bit of money. They didn't really think we were going to get anywhere at that stage. And we were pretty much made aware of it. Don't You Want Me is always going to be both frustration and our saviour. You know, the reason that you're talking to me now is because we made that song. The reason I'm in the music business 30 years later, when I've, you know, not got any standard talents whatsoever, is we came up with one song and we never spoilt it, luckily. And when we did the video, we didn't spoil it. Along the way, most people spoil their things. I think that Adrian, who was the guy who was from film school in the group, knew Steve somehow. I don't know if he'd met him at a party or something like that. You were working as a waitress in a cocktail bar. And I seem to think that he introduced him to us. And Adrian was very excited that it was going to be done on 35mm.
I think at the time not one music video had been shot on 35mm or could have afforded to do it. And because I remember that was the battle, and that almost the whole concept of the thing was, this will be 35mm, you know, like kind of, now let us do it. Concept became, I was obsessed at the time with Jacqueline Bisset and Day for Night. So I wanted to do a film within a film, and I thought, like everything that we did in music videos, let's push it further, let's do a film within a film within a film within a film. And what does that mean? And you know, and it means, well, if you're in the cutting room and you've been around the film and then you pull out and then you're in the cutting room, it's not in the cutting room, it's on the, you know. So it was really pushing it.
I think I lost count of the layers. It neither adds to the story of the song nor takes away from the story of the song. I mean, the song is the story of a film anyway. It's A Star Is Born. That's the idea.
I felt that if I could do something that had a number of characters, just really giving people roles that they didn't necessarily have to do too much, add too much drama to. I think the idea also came from, I'd been on a number of night shoots when I was a clapper loader, and I remember running to the van with the roll of film to reload. And on a night shoot, there was always that wonderful thing of, if you'd get a pool of very bright light, and as you came away from the actual set itself, it all became like a little space station, a little Close Encounters event that's going on. And that walk. I was working as a waitress in a cocktail bar. That was all very much that run I used to do as a clapper loader. I did a bunch of videos for Humour League, and I really respected him as an artist. But they would sit in the bus before every video we did, and I'd be like, "Can we get him out here?" And they're like, "Phil has said that he doesn't want to be a pop star." And I said, "Well, it's too late. He is one. Get him out here. Get him on set." There's that kind of Sheffield acerbic quality that just meant that you had to kind of cajole them into doing what they were actually really good at.
Well, I was really underconfident as an actor. John and Susan were always very confident about everything. I mean, they were partly found because they were dancing in a club somewhere, ignoring what anyone thought of them. You could rely on John and Susan to make things look better.
The thing is, less is more. If you really look at that, they're not doing an awful lot. It's all about the kind of cold stare. I remember my sister Siobhan, who was a producer, there was a problem of, like, it was always a costume thing, it was always a last minute thing of, you know, I'm not wearing that, you know, from the band, or I might wear that. And we didn't have anything for Susan. Don't you want me? Siobhan had a great coat, perfect. It's now kind of sort of iconic, actually, that walk and that look and that whole march. I think it even changed a little bit of high street fashion at the time.
Well, I was wearing Julian Temple's leather coat, and I managed to hang on to it for 5 or 6 years before he insisted that he get it back. And it took me years to find one as good. I remember it being very, very cold. We went out to some fields near Slough, and I think it got to about 4 in the morning, so it looks sort of nice-ish, but we were all absolutely freezing to death.
Yeah, I think it was a 3-day shoot. Maybe it was an all-nighter, exterior all night, and then we went into a studio with a gap of a day. We got the rushes back, and then we could put it on the steam boats. I think Human League, Don't You Want Me, was the second video on MTV, but after Video Killed the Radio Star, and the channel didn't look back for 10 years, you know, good, great decade. Don't you want me, baby? Don't you want me
now. Fascination was just a great idea. One great idea, that's what you need for a piece of art, isn't it? And there's a spot on the map, and he made the spot on the map work. If it seems a little time is needed, decisions to be made. The good advice of friends unheeded, the best of plans mislaid. But, I mean, there were people living in those houses as well. The guy, the house that we actually filmed the band scenes in had a guy living in the other rooms before he was moved out and the whole area was demolished. They were knocking it all down, you know. It was fine painting it. Was it grey outside and red inside, or red inside and grey outside? And so the conversation. Yeah, and the instruments were all grey, weren't they? Until the sun. That's how it should be, isn't it? It shouldn't be camera tricks. And many fantasies were learned.
There was always this problem with the early music videos that you had politics, band politics. It was like, okay, the lead singer obviously is going to get more time, but then exactly how much time does the bass player get on screen? How much time does the drummer get on screen? How much, you know, share is there for everyone? And obviously some members of the band are more charismatic and more photogenic than others. but you end up sitting in the cutting room with the record company saying, oh, we've got to have a bit more of so-and-so or whatever.
We were a genuinely democratic group. There were six people in the group. Everyone was exactly as important. And to be honest, our best songwriter was a guy called Joe Callis, who was keyboard, guitars. And as he said, that meant he might as well come in and just have his hand made up, because that was all that was going to be shown on the video. So then you've got your mate, he's a really nice guy, and he's sitting there upset for 2 days. While suddenly you get turned into Shirley Bassey, sort of. And you feel embarrassed that suddenly you're made more important than you've been through the whole process. On that day, keep feeling fascination, passion burning, lots of... Some people are great at being backroom boys. Ian, our bass player, that was his strength almost, and it made him really good. But Joe was multi-talented, at least as good a singer as me, and that made it tough. And we all, you know, you stick together while you're recording. There's often fights against record companies and producers and things, and suddenly you're divided, and it's back to the old thing. You're the singer, so you get all the attention. It wasn't fair. Well, my brother always thought that a video was there to distract viewers from that horrible music going on in the background. And I think that occasionally you could have enough fuss made about it that maybe people did do better than they should have. Well, music videos were the difference between success and failure to us. That in the same way that our music was very timely, if we'd done our records a year later or a year earlier, we wouldn't have made it. The times that we got involved in the concepts and we had a director that we could tell what to do were the least successful times, I think. And although we hated it, if someone walked in and said, I've got a good idea for you, and we would grumble, but we were so aware of how much it was costing. A video cost half of what you'd paid to make your album, but that you did over 6 months, 9 months, you could edge it along. You went and did a video for 2 or 3 days, and if you messed it up, you'd thrown away half your next album. But you were really aware, and to have someone walk in with a good concept was incredibly valuable. One of our key concepts was that we were never going to allow a stylist in, we were never going to allow a choreographer in, no one was going to get told what to wear, they were going to decide themselves what to wear, and the individuality was as important as anything. I always had a certain set of things that I tried to present to the public. You know, for instance, when I had photographs taken, I absolutely would not smile under any circumstance. My theory was that people wanted you to be serious. They were going out and spending a large amount of the wages they'd earned that week, and they didn't want to think that you're somewhere going, those idiots have bought that record, what a laugh. I tried to push that in videos. I tried to never sit down in a video. And that was a hard battle. But it just simply was the money. Someone would walk in and say, you cannot waste that money. And we were so scared. As soon as you start earning a bit of money, you're scared about losing it. And we just buckled under. I mean, later on, I got so jealous when I heard about George Michael throwing videos away because his haircut was wrong. And I was like, wow, why didn't we do that? It was was really exciting to be doing Electric Dreams because we were in Los Angeles, and obviously really do love America anyway, and it was great to be over there. I had a little scene with Virginia Madsen in it, so every time she comes up in a film on TV, I nudge my girlfriend and say, oh yes, I remember doing my scene with Virginia, yes. Ha ha. Sunset, and the camera car broke down. They decided to transfer it to another, and everyone dropped what they were doing, from catering to everyone, and ran over and started dismantling a car and putting another one together. We're driving around with all the locals and the hookers watching us. The scene where we climbed onto the top of the highest sound stage. It was MGM, wasn't it? The highest sound stage in Hollywood. For some reason, I decided I would go up a ladder in the middle of the thing. And halfway up, I suddenly realised I could fall off this. I was so tired. It never occurred to me there was a ladder so long that you couldn't climb it. But I did manage to get to the top. And then they'd made the mistake of leaving some yellow paint and large brushes, you know. And we're a little bit of a punky band. We're sort of electro punky glam. And so I was on top of MGM scrawling slogans on their maintenance hut on the top. I think there was HL Rule. And I think I put an American graffiti up there, really largely as well, because I was into 2000 AD at the time. Was sort of just mutually helpful. Steve was a nice guy. We enjoyed the way he did things. He didn't really pressure us, and he put us in for little things that we wouldn't have done.
What the hell's going on?
I don't get it. I'm not playing anything.
Where is it coming from?
Beats me. Bailey, get that
computer. George Amoroda is still my hero. I still think he's the key synth-pop guy that everyone ignores, and it gave me a chance to go and record the single. I think we were number two in about half the countries of the world, so we got an LP out of it about a year later, so no one bought it at all. And then it gave them a nice little song for the end of the film. There's a lot of warmth about Andy. He's one of those guys that you can't help liking. He's got a way of he's very diplomatic in a sort of without being able to spot it way, and you would just do things for him anyway. On Human, I think I lay down on a bench and had water dripped in my eyes for several hours, and now I'm thinking, why did I put up with that? But there was something about Andy.
Come on, baby, dry.
Glam was just huge. Everything punk was glam in Sheffield. It was like the same kids that had been into Roxy Music and David Bowie just added some safety pins and ripped their clothes a bit. Well, our breakthrough was glam. The fact that we knew we didn't fit in with the macho people. No one was gay in the band, but we never wanted to be overbearing, sort of chauvinist men. So when glam came along and we could dress unisex and, you know, a lot of makeup. Until my hair fell out, I was still wearing a lot of blue eyeshadow and stuff. And, it, you know, it's lucky my hair did fall out, or I'd be doing it now.
Human, born to make mistakes. So many nights I long to...
There were all sorts of issues over the way we looked. They put Don't You Want Me Out in America without any pictures of us on, because they thought it would cross over into the black market and they didn't want to put any black kids off with them thinking we were white. But for the album that we did, Human, we went straight into the middle of the black American industry, which Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, with a little studio they'd got together. And in fact, they were independent, but when they realised that mainly we couldn't play, they just didn't understand why we're in a band, that we were quite proud to be not very good musicians. Whereas they, you know, they were turning you away if you hadn't done 12 years saxophone. We didn't fit in America. They liked a couple of our records. We had a couple of number ones. They never understood us, they never loved us, and they never really bought very many albums. I'm still ambitious to break America 30 years on, oddly, because we're sort of saturated in a lot of places. But in America, I still think it's waiting to understand us, you know. And if Justin Timberlake can get out his old Casios and 808s and have hits, I don't see why we can't go over and do it.